Namaste and welcome to my channel. I'm going to cover the topic of hypospadias in the subsequent videos. Now, I know this is an important topic during our post-graduation days, but unfortunately we did not have much exposure to these cases and it always used to be very confusing. So in the next couple of videos, I will try and take you through the important topics and hope that I can clear a few basics for you. So we will start with embryology. Now, I know embryology always is a little overwhelming, but I find it easier if you try to understand it in retrospect. So if we already know about the external urogenital system, it is easier to understand where it came from. So let's begin with the embryology. Now, the developmental period will be described over a period of few weeks. So we begin with the formation of the cloaca. Now, the cloaca is a common structure from where the urogenital system and the anorectal system, they all form, and this is the most important structure which you have to remember. So the cloaca is at the period of 4 weeks, essentially a common structure where the cloacal membrane will then form and it will divide it into the following structures. So around the period of the 7th week, what happens is that this cloacal membrane is going to start growing into the cloaca and it is going to divide it into a urogenital system and the anorectal system. Now, after this division has occurred, further we will see how the urogenital system is separated from each other. Now, during this period of time, it is important to remember that there will also be the formation of the genital tubercle, which is going to help form the external genitalia. Now, the description following it is going to be for the male external genitals, but remember that hypospadias is something which also occurs in a very rare form in females. But as far as the video description is concerned, I will be talking about the male anomaly. So what happens after this period of 7 weeks is that as the gradual development occurs, so initially it is a common system, and depending on the hormonal influence of estrogen or testosterone coming from the testes and the ovaries, the development will begin and the differentiation into the male and female genitals will begin. Now what happens here, you can see, is that as the hormonal influence occurs, by the period of 7th week, so we initially saw a sagittal section of how the differentiation occurs, and now this is the view of the external genitals. So the genital tubercle which began to develop is going to help form the phallus. And furthermore, at the period of time where on either side you see there is a development of the labioscrotal or the genital swellings, which are just another pair of elevations. Now remember, in future, in the males, this is going to form the scrotum or the labia majora in case of the females. Now, since the development is from a common urogenital system, the phallus is forming the genitalia, whereas the urinary part of it is going to form from this urethral groove. Now, what is important here that you need to remember is how the gradual differentiation of these two systems will occur. Now, the urethral groove is going to obviously form the urethral part of it, and the phallus elongates and it is going to form the glands part of it. Now, the phallus, which is going to contain the erectile tissue, which will have the corpus cavernosum, and the urethral structures which will have the corpus spongiosum as they keep on growing. By this time, the anus development has also occurred and it has separated itself from the urogenital system. Now, it is important to remember that this has occurred by the period of 9 weeks. And the complete development, where you can identify the male or the female external genitalia, occurs by a period of 12 weeks. So what happens at this period of 12 weeks is as follows. Now you have to remember at this time that there are two ectodermal invaginations that will occur. Now these ectodermal invaginations will occur, one on the region of the glands, and it will also occur in a circumferential formation. So these two things are going to help form the glandular epithelial plate, which is going to be a part of the glands that is going to be continuous with the urethra in the body. And the second invagination, which is in the circular form, is going to help form the prepuce, which is going to be separated then from the glands. Now, an important thing also to remember is the development of the urethra. So the urethra is essentially in the entire part, obviously, of the body of the penis, but its opening is normally found only at the tip. So the closure of this system occurs from the caudal to the cranial direction, or from proximal to distal, and that is how the development of the urinary opening, the urethral opening, will also occur. That's why if the closure starts happening before a period of time, you end up with a hypospadias, because before it reaches the tip, the premature closure happens. So finally, what we see over here is that the development of the glands has taken place and the external urethral orifice has opened. The formation of the prepuce has occurred. The urethral tract has closed all along its route except for the opening at the tip. The penile body with the corpus cavernosum has formed. The spongiosum is surrounding the urethral part. On either side, from the labioscrotal swellings, you have the formation of the scrotum, and the anus obviously has separated it from itself. Now, the important few points to remember also are that the incidence of hypospadias is quite common, and it can be different where the Asian population or the Caucasian population is concerned. Although there is an important thing to remember is about the familial incidence, that yes, it does have a hereditary pattern, so it can be passed on from the father to the son. And if one sibling has hypospadias, there is a 9 to 17% chance that the second sibling, the male, would also have hypospadias. It is also found in a lot of syndromes like the Wagner syndrome, and it can be a part of Vacterl and other urogenital abnormalities. And it is also important to remember that a lot of maternal factors have been shown to have association with it. So maternal hypertension or oligohydroamnios, or in some cases in vitro fertilization, has also shown to increase the rate of the hypospadias formation. Now remember, it is called hypospadias and not hypospadiasis, as it is commonly mispronounced. So this was about the embryology. In the next video, I will cover about the anatomy and the subsequent videos, so forth.